Well, we're going to jump into the last section of the book of Habakkuk, which is on page 300, sorry, not 300, 942 in these blue Bibles, the ones that look like this. So if you've got one of those near you, please do grab it. While you're getting there, I'll just kind of like give us the overview. We've been looking at this book, and the reason that we looked at the book was because it asked some questions that we all ask. Things like, the big question is, if God is real, why doesn't he do something? If God is good, why is all the evil in the world? And Habakkuk has them kind of questions going on in his head and his heart at the start of this chapter. And as he has three chapters that he writes down, by the time he gets to this third chapter, it's like it's a different guy. It's a different person talking. And what has made that difference? Why has he now got a different perspective? Is he just, had his Happy Meal? Is that what's happened? He's had a couple of Happy Meals. He feels happy because that's what Happy Meals are meant to do, aren't they? Clues in the name. And he's, well, hey, all is well. Sun shining, all is well. So as we get there, I just want to read these verses out. We're going to read from verse 12 through to verse 19. And it's times like this when I realize I need my reading glasses. But here we go. So in verse 12, it says this: In wrath, this is speaking of God, in wrath you strode through the earth, and in anger you threshed the nations. You came out to deliver your people, to save your anointed one. You crushed the leader of the land of wickedness. You stripped him from head to foot. With his own spear, you pierced his head. When his warriors stormed out to scatter us, gloating as though about to devour the wretched who were in hiding, you trampled the sea with your horses, churning the great waters. I heard and my heart pounded. My lips quivered at the sound, and decay crept into my bones, and my legs trembled. Yet I will wait patiently for the day of calamity to come on the nation invading us. Though the fig tree does not bud, and there are no grapes on the vines, though the olive crops fails, and the fields produce no food, though there are no sheep in the sheepfold and no cattle in the stalls, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will be joyful in my God, in God my Savior. The sovereign Lord is my strength. He makes my feet like the feet of a deer. He enables me to tread on the heights. For the director of music on stringed instruments. So it's a psalm that he's composed in this last kind of chapter. Let's pray. Father, as we have your word before us, Lord, we do pray, Father, that it would be something that we treasure, something that would sink into our hearts, something that would give us insight and understanding into you. Amen. So I suppose speaking of the Christian life is probably what we're going to picture it as this morning. Characteristics of the Christian life. If someone were to describe you as a Christian, would they describe you as a joyful person? Who said yeah? Good solid yeah. So the rest of us, what? We all miserable. What's the deal here? Are we all just like, it's what? Fluctuating in joy. Oh, that's fair play. Anyone going to go, I'm just downright miserable? No? Brian? You? For those of you at home that missed that, Katie said, her face looks like it. No, it doesn't, Katie. But when people meet me, I'm like, no, your face doesn't look like that. All right, you've got a lovely smile. You radiate joy. That's the end of it. All right, none of that. Well, we're meant to be people of joy. We're meant to be people of victory. And so we're going to look at how that can be true if we are facing things that, sometimes we face some things that are just tough. Life is tough. So if we cast our mind back to chapter one, Habakkuk writes in the following terms. He says this: Lord, why do you make me look at injustice? Why do you tolerate wrongdoing? Destruction and violence are before me. There is strife and conflict. The law is paralyzed, and justice never prevails. The wicked hem in the righteous, so that justice is perverted. And it sounds like, as we've experienced this week, it sounds a bit like modern-day Britain, doesn't it? Violence on the streets. And Habakkuk wanted God to do something. And we do the same. We pray, as we did on Wednesday. We met together. We spent a bit of time in prayer. And we're praying, God, intervene. Do something. And we're praying, God, you know, God, we're doing the right thing. You know, you can do the right thing, and everything can be going wrong in your life. And God speaks to Habakkuk, and his reply is, Habakkuk, I am doing something. And it's the same to us. God says, I am doing something. God is always at work. Habakkuk's answer was that there was a judgment coming on the nation, and the judgment was the Babylonians. And we can articulate something similar. I would say this nation is under judgment. You can look at the things that are going on, and for me, it smacks of God's judgment on this land. How then are we meant to live? Well, it says the just, which is us, if you're not sure, we're the just, shall live by faith. That's God's answer in chapter 2. Our faith transforms our life, for we are people that have hope. With faith comes hope. Okay? With faith comes hope. And the characteristics of our life are based on the unchanging nature of God. They're not based on the circumstances, or they're not meant to be. Not always the case, though, is it? Sometimes circumstances can just lift us, or circumstances can take us down. And we've got to learn about how our faith can help us, okay? As we close this third chapter out, we can see that although the circumstances in Habakkuk's life did not change, so he's still got all the problems that he described in chapter 1, his outlook did change. His perspective, his mind, his heart, it was all different. And he could see that God was on the throne. And he could see God's perspective. And his perspective was so changed simply because he spent time with God. He talked to God. And God talked back to him. Now, in this third chapter, it's a glorious outlook, and it has rich and victorious language. So verses 12 to 16, I've called victory in Jesus. Verse 12, speaking of God, in wrath, you, Lord, strode through the earth, and in anger, you threshed the nations. As we saw last week, Habakkuk has got this different perspective. He now sees what God sees. He sees that Israel's under judgment, but the nations, they do the bidding of God. And God is the one who strides through the earth, a victor in the midst of all that's going on. This striding is defiant. He then threshes the nations as one threshes or beats out wheat. He does so with impunity. The picture of God is warlike, who nobody can stand before, is a picture not only of war, not only of all conquering, but of victory. God defeats all that stands in his way. And if God defeats all that stands in his way, if God is victorious, then we as his children can also have that perspective, a victorious perspective. This is what Habakkuk is starting out to say. This is Habakkuk, who started out saying, God, where are you? What are you doing? Now he writes, in wrath you walk through the earth. God, who did these things, he did them for a reason, and the reason is in verse 13. Look at verse 13 and see what it says. You came out to deliver your people. Let's say that again. You came out, God, you came out. Why did God come out? He came out on behalf of his people. We are his people. He loves us. He will do things on our behalf. He will intervene. He doesn't always intervene the way we want him to do, but he will intervene. He will act. He will move because he loves us and because he is the one who can do it. You came out, why? To deliver your people, to save your anointed one. The reason for this great show of strength is for and on behalf of his people. God showed up and showed off for his people. That's us. And we've got this expectation. The Lord's mission was not simply to punish and defeat his enemies. This is the God who acts to defend his people. You came out to deliver and to save. This deliverance and salvation is for a particular person. It says the anointed one. Who's that? As Habakkuk looks back into Israel's history, what he's doing is he's looking at all the godly leaders that existed in their history. So you had King David, you had Moses. Those are the two that stand out. There are other ones. But as he looks back, it points forwards. Moses mentioned when he was in the height of his ministry, says, there's going to come one after me, a prophet, who is going to knock your socks off. He didn't actually say knock your socks off. That's just me doing my modern day translation of Hebrew. What does that word say? Knock your socks off. That's what it says. David was told that his kingship, his lineage would go on forever. There would never be a person off the throne of David. That was who he was told thousands of years before Jesus came. Who fulfills these claims? It's King Jesus. The leader of leaders, there would be a leader who would come, who would offer salvation that had never been offered before. See, Habakkuk's looking back, he's going at Israel's history, and he's thinking of the time when they were in Egypt, which is a well-known story. Okay, the people cried out to God, and God says, right, I'm going to bring some plagues, bish, bash, bosh. Long story short, they exit Egypt. They then walk through loads of different nations, past these nations, and it says the fear of their God was on these nations because of what God had done. But what God did then is nothing like what God has done for us. What's God done for us? That's the interactive bit. He saved us. How did he save us? The what? Dying on the cross. God has done far greater things than he did with the Egyptians by sending his son to die for us. You two get a gold star later on. Okay. Keep a little register, a little gold star next to you lot. Rubbish. God sent his son. God sent his son to not only offer a deliverance and a salvation greater than what was going on with Egypt, it was offered for the whole world. One of the most often repeated phrases is, if God is so powerful, then where is he? Why does he not do something? And the answer is, one of the answers is, he's done something. He sent his son. That's what was needed. Why? Because his son, Jesus, went to the cross, took the sin of the world, took my place, took your place, and made a way to heaven where, to be honest, we shouldn't really get to go. It should be off limits for every human being on planet Earth, but Jesus made a way where there was no way so that you and I, lowly little sinners that we are, yes, we are. I know you look nice and I know you smile and got your Sunday best on. And I know if I talk to you, you're probably very, very lovely and very, very sweet and very, very nice, but we're all sinners saved by grace. Send it out quick. Let's get out there. God sent his son to offer a salvation that would change the whole world. And it did. It did change the world. You can track the movement of Christianity through the world, wherever it's gone, and see the good that it did. God has done something. He He sent his son, and he's still doing something. God intervened. His last words on the cross were, "It is finished." The deliverance, the salvation for the whole of humanity have been achieved, and now whoever believes on the name of the Lord Jesus shall be saved. God made it that easy. And yet, people don't want to believe. This morning, there's a gentleman sat on there, on the wall out there, and you know, 9 times out of 10, when people have sat down or stood round here, they're waiting for the drugs man to drop off. And I don't mean the chemist. I'm not talking about coins, the chemist. Little van pulls up with coins on it. It's not that kind of drugs. It's a different kind of drugs. And so I thought, while he's sat there, and while he's doing that, he can have a flyer. So I went, yeah, mate, explain to you about the gospel. I don't believe in God. What? Well, I don't believe in, well, I believe in something. Right? Well, either you believe or you don't, you know, which, where we're going, which way? Well, there's something out there, but I'm not sure. And you know. And I'm sat there going, there is a gift. God, Jesus spoke. He said, if you knew the gift of God in John chapter 4, if you knew the gift of God, you would snatch God's hand off. Nobody dislike, you know, I've never met anyone. You go up to someone and you've got like a little box with a little bow on it and all that, and you go up to them and go, and they go, I don't want that. You ever met anyone that does that? You know, I've got a prezi for you. Take it away. I don't want a prezi. God's gift to humanity is salvation through the cross of Jesus Christ. God has intervened. The Messiah has come. The Messiah has done it. And therefore, we have the victory that Jesus purchased on the cross, meaning that no matter what we go through, because we have the promise of heaven, we have something that will keep us going. You see, in this life, bad news is what dominates, isn't it? On your TV, it's bad news, the sensational, the worst, that's what dominates. And it calls us in, doesn't it? TV goes on. Breaking news. You're like, oh, what is it? And you're watching it, and bad news, and then there's more bad news, and then there's more bad news, and there's more. That demotivates you. If you want to get motivated, get the good news. The good news is in the good book about the promises of God, about how God is with you, about how God is for you, about how God would send out an army on your behalf just for one of you who are his children. Because all you get is bad news. Get out of bed in the morning. That's all there to go on. The Messiah has come. Jesus has come. In other words, we can rejoice when we should be mourning. We can laugh when we should be crying. And we can continue on when everything is telling us to stop. Motivation, just throw this one out now. This is just a personal thing. I've never, ever, 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 one more, ever struggled to be motivated until I became a pastor. Blow my neck. The stuff that wants to demotivate you is a, you know, the stuff that goes on in your head, goes on inside of you, the way you react to stuff. I'm like, crikey. No wonder there's, what is it, something like 200 churches without pastors in the UK at the moment or something, I don't know. Because it's never been a problem for me until I became a pastor. And now I'm going, oh, don't want to do this. And I'm like, who's that? Never used to be like that. I have to find motivation. I have to find victory. I have to find it through faith in God's word, through what he's done. It goes on. You crush the leader of the land of wickedness. You stripped him from head to foot. And with his own spear, you pierce his head. With his warriors stormed out to scatter us, gloating as though about to devour the wretched who were in hiding. You trampled the sea with your horses, churning the great waters. This next verse takes us back to that Exodus thing, where we all know Moses, he stood on the edge of the Red Sea. The armies are chasing him down. Pharaoh had said to him, you can go and worship. Then Pharaoh changes his mind. The armies are pounding in, thinking, we've got the Israelites. We're going to absolutely sort them out. And God intervenes at the last minute and makes a way where there was no way. And by looking back at what God had done, Habakkuk had the encouragement for what God would do in his own time. So in other words, the stuff that goes on in the Bible, the history, the interventions that God did are our encouragement for our time. Okay? We can look back to the cross, look back at what God has done, and see the power, the goodness, the greatness of God in what he's done on the cross. Now, on Wednesday night, we have this discussion about the cross. And the question was asked, you know, what was so upside down? I can't remember exactly the words, but what was so upside down about the Luke's description of the cross? And it was this. Jesus was hanging on the cross. The Romans were looking on. The Pharisees were looking on. People were mocking. Why was that kind of like an upside down thing? And the answer was that the Romans were the might and all-powerful superpower of the day, yet the most powerful man on the planet was on the cross. If you stepped out of line, the Roman authorities would crucify you. It was an excruciating and horrible death, but it's their way of saying we're the powerful ones. And yet the most powerful one was crucified. Who were the ones that everyone thought would lead them to heaven? They were the Pharisees. Who were the one that went to heaven? It was the thief on the cross next to Jesus. You see, a lot of the times we can look at people and we can look at outside stuff and think they have got it all together. They're the ones that are going to heaven. And Jesus says, it is the one who has me in their heart, who loves me, that is going to heaven. The cross turns everything upside down, and it is the power of God. The cross was a symbol of Roman's power. It became a symbol of God's power. An empty cross with a resurrected Jesus. Paul says this, the same power that raised Jesus Christ from the dead dwells in us as believers. A believer, a born-again believer, accepts the Holy Spirit, repents of sin, Holy Spirit comes into life, God's power is then available to that individual. And this is something that God has been speaking to me about a lot recently. In our evangelism course on Wednesday, the first session was about waiting for God to lead you to the right person. And it's simple stuff, but I'm like, oh yeah, forgot about that. Waiting on God, rather than doing what I do, which is I run around, busy, 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 and God's like, yeah, I'm over here, Nick. I'm just like, you know, and I'm like, I'll do this, I'll do this, I'll do this, I'll get this done. Da, 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 da. Wait on him. Wait on him for him to lead you. Spirit-filled and Spirit-led were the marks of the early church. So if you want to know what it looks like, read the book of Acts. How do we know if our church is doing well? Look at the characteristics of the early church. And you'll find that in some areas, I think, box ticked. And in other areas, room for improvement. Now, joy in Jesus, verses 16 to 19. The tone of these last few verses changes as the prophet considers his own standing. I heard and my heart pounded. My lips quivered at the sound. Decay crept into my bones and my legs trembled. He was waiting on God. God had been speaking to him. And the event was traumatic. God has spoken and said what he had said. He'd written it down, but the emotional toll on him was exhausting. And now at the end of this mini-psalm, he reflects on what he's heard and what awaits his nation. Some of the things that history records happening to the Jewish nation are actually quite shocking. Habakkuk does not know how long he has to wait before God will intervene and set them free. Time scales are God's business. You know, we're all like, God, do it now. God's like, I've got a different time scale. And as he waits, the effect of it makes him physically shake and his heart pounds. The revelations that came to him affected him physically. And against this backdrop, you probably expect him to say, this is too much. I'm giving up. But he says, I will wait patiently for the day of calamity. Now, patience is one of them gifts that we want everybody else to have, isn't it? Like, you know, God, make them all patient. But I'm all right. You know what I mean? I think I'm patient. But them lot, make them patient. If you want to walk with God and you want it to be a close thing, you're going to have to learn patience. It's just the way it is. Habakkuk would employ patience, that indescribable God quality that we wish everyone else had. And we really don't need it, but we do. The patience was for the destruction of the oppressors. So he's saying, I know what's coming to my nation, but I know that at some point you will set us free. Then he says these words, though the fig tree does not bud, there are no grapes in the vines, though the olive crop fails and the fields produce no food, though there's no sheep in the pen, no cattle in the stalls, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. The fig tree is particular for Israel. It's a metaphor for them. Israel had not been fruitful. They had not blossomed and shared their faith with other nations. But more than this, the whole agricultural lifestyle that they depended upon had failed. The land that was meant to produce flow with milk and honey was a land of failing crops and fields that produced no food. The flocks had been scattered, leaving a picture of economic devastation. Think of certain parts of the Ukraine. That's what it was like. Just blitzed. An invading army had come along and wiped it all out. Totally devoid of any elements that make up a community. In the midst of this bleak picture, he says, yet. And then he pivots. I will rejoice. What? Imagine standing in the middle of the devastation of the war in the Ukraine, seeing the destruction of the Russian army, and then saying, I will rejoice. People would go, you lost it, mate. What? I will rejoice. This is what faith now brings. It brings a rejoicing. It is not based in what you can see, the circumstances. It's based in what you can't see, the unchangeable nature of God. I will rejoice and joy, enjoy my God. Why? Because he's good. Even though this speaks of bad things, I'm going to praise him. What have you got to rejoice about, Habakkuk? I'll rejoice in the Lord and in his saving power and in the fact that I know him and in the fact that I know he's with me. He, God, is my joy. He's the one who is an inexhaustible source of joy to me. Sometimes God will put you in a place where there's nowhere left to go but God. Sometimes it's just like that. And sometimes that's not easy or nice. But if you find joy in God, enjoying God, enjoying his presence, you can continue on. He is my salvation. The prophet's faith had been strengthened. He was jubilant in the face of all this gloom. It is good and right and fitting to rejoice when all is well. But when things aren't going great, Can we still do it? Can we lay hold of what is not yet seen and rejoice? That's a measure of true faith. Now, things are going great. You know, you're on your jollies. Way, praise the Lord. Sun's shining. I'm on the beach. Way, thank you, Jesus. But when things aren't going great, what are we like? To finish, this is what it says. The sovereign Lord is my strength. He makes my feet like the feet of a deer. He enables me to tread on the heights. Habakkuk does not stop there. He acknowledges that God has what God has not done in his spirit. He's convinced that the Lord is who he says he is. He can do great things. Sovereign over the nations, because of his confidence, God makes his spirit, is the internal him, see things differently, go to high places. It's a perfect picture of no matter what the circumstance or how bad things appear, we have a God who can take us to heights of joy and jubilation. And in doing so, he is the source of our life. As Paul says, I've learned the secret of being content regardless of what the situation is. In 1851, just to finish off now, an English missionary named Alan Gardner was shipwrecked. Along with other survivors, they made it to a small, remote, uninhabited island off the tip of South America. There, the castaways slowly, one by one, died of starvation. As far as we can tell, Alan Gardner was the last one alive. As a Christian, he'd kept a journal where he reflected on scripture. When the bodies were discovered, the journal was found next to his deceased body. And the last entry in the journal was his reflections on Psalm 34, verse 10. The young lions suffer want and hunger, but those that seek the Lord lack no good thing. Psalms 34, verse 10. All alone, as he dangled between life and death, as he meditated on this passage, the last thing he wrote in his journal was this: I am overwhelmed by the goodness of God. Here was a dying man, dying of starvation, far from home. He was on his own. He was alone. His body was broken. He had no hope. Yet the last words describe how he was overwhelmed by the goodness of God. Can we say that in the tough times? That is when we find out whether we've got joy that nobody can take away. Let's pray. Father, as we consider what you've given us, which is your Son, sent from heaven, as we consider what that means to us, perhaps, and maybe there's someone in here this morning who doesn't fully understand what we've been talking about. And so with our heads bowed and as we close our eyes, Father, I just ask for you, by your Spirit now, that you'd move. And if there's anyone that wants to completely understand what we've talked about, that you'd lift your hand up and let me know, and I can pray a prayer of faith with you. Just take a few minutes out of our service to reflect and think about. Father, we consider the victory that you brought through the death of your Son, as we consider joy that you've given through the life of the resurrected Savior. Father, I pray that in our hearts we would set ourselves so that our joy would be in you. We would set ourselves so that we find victory in the knowledge that you've conquered it all. So that, like Paul, we can say, in all of these things, we are more than conquerors. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.